registered dietitian nutritionist and host of Living Healthy, Living Well. On today's episode, we're going to be going through everyday eating and show you how you can make a lot of little practical tips to make your everyday eating in a healthier way. Today, I'm also going to be having on a dear friend of mine and colleague, Mary Donkersloot, acclaimed registered dietitian nutritionist in Beverly Hills, California. The MyPlate was discovered in 2011 to replace the old food guide pyramids, which is much more convenient for consumers because we tend to eat off more plates than we do pyramids. And the food guide pyramids tended to emphasize a little too many grains and not as many fruits and vegetables. Just looking at the MyPlate image, the first thing you should notice is that half the plate is filled with produce, namely fruits and vegetables. Some people say that they don't eat both fruits and vegetables at every meal, so a nice way to think about it is to have half your plate fruit at breakfast and snacks, and half your plate vegetables at lunches and dinners. That way we're making sure that about 50% of our intake is from produce, which really will help in our overall weight management and also disease prevention. The next thing we should notice when looking at the MyPlate is that the protein section and the carbohydrate grain section are about equal in size. So thinking about mashed potatoes and a piece of chicken, roughly about the same size. Whereas the average American tends to eat about 1 gram of protein to about 10 servings of these carbohydrates. So that's why the plate is really nice, because it gives you that concept of breaking it down so you can visually investigate the plate and make sure about 50% is filled with produce, 25% is filling your protein needs, and 25% is filling that grains and carbohydrate needs. So now let's break down the plate a little bit further and explore each food group on its own. So we said that we want to make half our plate either filled with fruits or vegetables or both at every single meal. Now, one thing is we really just want to get the more the merrier, especially when it comes to vegetables. The more vegetables means a fuller stomach filled with vitamins, minerals, water, and lots of fiber. Really good for keeping us full and keeping us satisfied and having us crave, you know, the denser foods a little less often. So another thing for extra credit when choosing fruits and vegetables is we want to get more colors, because more colors represents a wider variety of antioxidants. So the more colors, the better. And a really good trick for that is when you're going in the supermarket, just try to compete with your fellow shoppers and you want to have the most colorful basket in the store. The next thing we want to go into are the carbohydrate grain section. Like I said, the average American tends to consume a little too many of these. In fact, if you're looking at a standard entree of fettuccine Alfredo, you'll notice it's about 95% of those grains, maybe like 2% vegetables if you're getting a pinch of chives or spice, and a little bit of protein in the fettuccine sauce. So the main thing we want to notice with these carbohydrates is we want to keep them in that 25% of our plate category, one good quarter of the plate. Another thing when choosing these grains is we want to go for whole grains. Now, one trick that most people don't realize is that all rice starts as brown rice. So how do they turn brown rice into white rice, you ask? Well, basically, the first thing they do, if you're looking at the structure of a grain, is they remove that outer layer, which is the bran. The bran is where all the fiber is. Fiber is what keeps us full and really maintains a good, healthy gut. And it also contains our B vitamins, which are essential for energy production, but also for maintaining a metabolism. So when you're going to white grains, you're stripping it of that really good, healthy outer layer. And you're left with just that endosperm center. And that endosperm center, if you notice, isn't perfectly white. So they tend to bleach it with a little bit of dye to get it that stark white rice that we're used to on our sushi. So it's a really good idea to always choose more fiber, because you're just gonna be fuller, more satisfied, and have a better overall hunger satisfaction later on in the day. The next category we want to go into are the proteins. Protein is really important, and there are a lot of great protein sources, vegetarian and animal found. And again, this is something that we want to make a quarter of our plate. So my best trick for protein sources is go for things with less legs. What do I mean by that? Well, eggs and fish and yogurt don't walk. They don't have any legs. So these are some good things to choose more often. Same goes with beans and nuts, yogurt, cheese, fish, like I said, tofu, all really good options because having less legs also shows that they tend to have less fat around those body parts. The next one is the two-legged animals. Those are like your chicken and your turkey. Now, those are the next best option because the fat tends to stay localized in the skin. So if you can remove the skin from your chicken and turkey, you're left with a really good piece of lean protein. That's why those are the next best bets. And then lastly, we have those four-legged animals. And those are like the cow and the pig and the lamb. Now, the reason we want to choose those a little less often is because they have a lot of marbling. Marbling means the fat is kind of interspersed within the meat, which makes it very flavorful, but also makes it very high in unavoidable saturated fat, because you really just can't cut it out perfectly. So that's why we want to choose those less often, but they're still really good and part of a healthy overall diet. Now, when thinking about trying to keep the ratio of protein to the carbohydrate, these are mashed potatoes, by the way. When we're talking about trying to keep these in a ratio of about 1:1, we really need to evaluate some very common foods. One being sandwiches. So when you go to a restaurant and you get a 6-inch sandwich, we need to realize that's like a really big piece of bread. And then you have a little thin layer of protein, a little thin layer of vegetables, and then another huge piece of bread. So in trying to make this ratio of 1:1 work for you, sometimes it helps to take off that top layer of bread. So we're more in line with that really good ratio of having one serving of protein to one serving of good, healthy carbohydrates. Now, one thing that's not on this plate are a lot of extra fats and sugars. You don't just see piles hanging out in the corner of the My Plate image. So one thing we want to notice is that there are natural fats and sugars in all of these nutritious foods. For instance, you can find healthy fat in things like chicken, fish, coconut, nuts, avocado, and so forth. And you also find natural sugars in a lot of these fruits and also in your greens and vegetable category. So it's a really good idea to not go for so many of the extras when it comes to the fats and sugars. So if you need to saute a big bowl of vegetables with a little bit of olive oil, then that's all good, but we want to avoid when it becomes in excessive amounts. Sometimes that happens when we're talking about tempura rolls or deep fried foods or really creamy, oversaturated with fat dressings and so forth. That also plays in a role with sugar when you're talking about things like candy and sugar sweetened beverages that are really composed of mostly sugar. So it's a really good idea to choose the healthy fats more often. Healthy fats are gonna come from foods already present in the My Plate, like the avocado and the olives and the egg yolk, like we discussed. And then when it comes to sugar, we really wanna be finding them again in our natural foods, like fruit. So one good suggestion, if you wanna spice up your water, is to slice some fruit into your water. I think strawberries work perfectly. Watermelon, lemons, oranges are also a huge plus. Now, when it comes to drinking water, we really need a lot of it. In our brain, in our hypothalamus, we have a sense of hunger and thirst, and they're right next to each other. And really often, we confuse hunger for thirst, or thirst for hunger. So it's really important to stay hydrated throughout the day. One really good tip and equation is take your weight in pounds. So for instance, if you weigh 200 pounds and divide it by 2, which would be 100. 100 is about as many ounces of water as you need to drink per day, which would be about 5 20-ounce water bottles. So again, the equation is take your weight in pounds, divide it by 2, and try to get in that many ounces of fluids per day. And you probably will find that your craving for a lot of extra food will go down because you're really replacing that, you know, fake sense of hunger with relieving your thirst. And that really covers the My Plate. So how are we gonna eat in these categories like the My Plate shows? Because we don't necessarily always eat like this, right? We don't necessarily always have our starch, our vegetable, and our protein. So we have to get a little creative and become an investigator. So when it comes to something like minestrone soup, if it's really, really, really big, and has a lot of shredded chicken in it, and it has a good whole grain pasta in it, and has beans, and has lots of vegetables, and a big tomato broth base, that could be a really filling dish if it's big enough to become a meal. So to be an investigator, we have to notice that there are potatoes in there, which tend, and pasta in there, which tend to act as our starches or grains or carbohydrate category. We added shredded chicken, so we have our protein category, and we have lots of vegetables swimming in there as well. So when you're offered by a restaurant to put your minestrone soup into a big bread bowl, we need to think back to the My Plate and those ratios and realize that we don't really need that. And that a huge bowl of soup with lots of goodies in it can be a really good satisfying meal. Another example would be a big salad niçoise. So big salad niçoises tend to have eggs in it and tuna in it, which make for really great protein sources. They tend to also have a lot of like steamed potatoes, which can act as our carbohydrate category. And then they're on a big bed of lettuce, and you're getting a lot of good healthy fats from the egg yolk, the olives, and maybe a little lemon juice and olive oil dressing. So we really just need to take our eyes and examine food and kind of break it down and see how it's gonna work with a My Plate image. Today we are honored to have nutritionist Mary Donkersloot in the studio with us today. With over 20 years of experience, Mary currently has a private practice in Beverly Hills, helping clients overcome eating and weight issues. She also specializes in pediatric and adolescent weight management and regularly lectures at St. John's Hospital and eating disorder clinics. Mary has also written 3 books spanning a wide range of topics and has consulted with major corporations, including Kraft Foods, Starbucks, Quaker, and many others. Welcome to the studio, Mary.
Thanks, Ilana. It's really nice to be here.
So nice to have you. So some things we're all thinking about is, what are some common trends you see in people's diets before they start meeting with you?
Well, it's interesting because today's consumers are pretty sophisticated. I'm usually not the first dietitian they've seen, and probably not the first diet they've tried. So I hear them do the paleo diet.
Right.
They might be doing a low-carb diet. Mark Hyman's approach, you know, I'm just thinking of people I saw today. And so it's, people are confused.
Right.
And they just don't know quite what to do. Should it be low carb? Should it be high protein? You know, should it be gluten free? Maybe it should have no sugar or no dairy. It's a lot of no's.
Right. Too many no's.
And so people are just rattled and confused.
Right. I also find working with people in the Southern California area, it might be like maybe just a little more bombarded with a lot of health claims in our area possibly.
You know, I think that's true. And to our credit, you know, it's sunny and warm here and we don't wear as many clothes as they do back east, and people want to look good, you know, and so there's a real incentive to want to eat healthfully. And also, you know, fruits and vegetables, and, you know, they grow here. And there is just this preponderance of interest of that because of the environment.
Right.
And I think that's a good thing.
So do you find that a lot of your clients start off eating a lot of fruits and vegetables even before meeting with you?
You know, it's interesting, and it varies, and certainly not everybody I see is born and raised in Southern California, because
right.
we have a lot of transplants like you and you.
Of course.
And me. But I think that, you know, one of the things that I often notice is not eating enough vegetables.
Right.
And it may not be because they don't like them. It's just that that's not what's coming at us 24/7.
Right.
You know, there are lots of protein bars. Everybody's eating
Great
some
point.
Kind of a bar, but they might not be eating, you know, the cauliflower we were talking about
exactly.
before we started. You know?
Exactly.
So if we can make some of those trades, that's helpful.
And that's a really good point, is protein bars, very easy to get that
that's
food
right.
group on the go whenever. But
that's
vegetables,
right.
which is something we want to make at least 50% of our intake,
right.
is so hard to find. Are there any type of vegetables you find are easy, like on the go and more accessible than others?
Well, I like to look for those people who don't cook very often for the less perishable vegetables.
Right.
Because one of the things that can happen is somebody will say, oh yeah, I never cook, but I'm going to start now. And I'm going to make a lot of things. And then they go to the market and they buy a lot of stuff. They go to the farmer's market and they have bags full.
Right.
And then, you know, week and a half later, they toss them. They haven't.
So what are some good ones?
So one of the things I usually tell people is plan to cook once this week. If they're not cooking at all, cook once.
That's great.
And so, you know, it depends on what people like, and I like to start there. But, you know, the cruciferous cabbage family are great. You know, you can buy a head of cabbage and slice it up and saute it in a little olive oil with some onions, a little salt and pepper.
Right.
Fabulous.
And that will stay a couple of days in the fridge for sure.
Cabbage will keep for weeks in the fridge. You know, cauliflower, broccoli. One of the funny things I see is, it's not really funny, it's kind of sad, where the mom comes in and says, now I put broccoli on the table every night and Johnny just doesn't eat it. He won't touch it. And it's there every single night. Well, it's steamed broccoli with no fat,
right,
no olive oil, no garlic, no flavor, no salt. It's just steamed broccoli. The kid doesn't like it. So sometimes what I find is that, you know, kids like things that taste good.
Totally.
We all like things that taste good.
Definitely.
And so with vegetables, I find you have to, you know, make them taste good. And then
absolutely. And a little fat goes a long way with something
absolutely.
Like cabbage.
Absolutely. You know, and, you know, my magic way to get kids and adults to eat more vegetables is, you know, a little olive oil, some fresh garlic, you saute them or you roast them in the oven, a tiny little bit of kosher salt, and they're delicious.
All good. Yeah, I love them too. What do you find motivates people to change their everyday eating, getting more vegetables? Like, what are some big motivating factors you see for wanting to make such a big lifestyle change in the way they eat?
Well, two things motivate people. One is vanity, the other is health. I mean, you know, it's a toss-up which one it is. I think in my history, health can be a motivator, but it's not as concrete sometimes as vanity. Now, when somebody's doctors told them they're on the verge of getting diabetes or they have type 2 diabetes, that can alarm them to the point where they pick up the phone and call me and say, help.
Right.
So I do, but even those people, they want to fit into their clothes
for
that
sure.
they used to fit into, or they want to be able to have more energy. They want to keep up with their grandchildren or their children. And so I think it's both. I think ultimately what keeps people engaged in the process of making healthier choices is feeling good.
Right.
And that's the cool thing about eating well is that you feel better, like, fast. Mm-hmm. It doesn't take weeks and weeks. It takes a long time to lose weight, but as soon as you cut back on your eating, if you're overeating and you cut back, you feel better the next day.
Right, energy.
I mean, you feel better the next meal. So, and you have more energy, you're mentally, you know, more on top of things. It just gives you a sense of control.
Absolutely, for sure, I definitely see that. What do you find are the easiest adjustments one can make to their everyday eating to really just get it on the right track as soon as possible?
You know, one of the first questions I ask my patients is, are you happy with your eating pattern?
Mm-hmm.
And often they say no. You know, someone was telling me this morning that, you know, it was a woman who was a comedy writer, and she's at a table with 12 people, and in the middle of that table is chips and nuts and some fruit, but the red vines and candy and licorice and cookies and all day long.
Right.
And so since she got this job, she gained 10 pounds.
I don't blame her.
And so the problem was that her meals were really tiny because she was eating all these snacks.
Right.
And so what we realize is that her meals need to be bigger, and that would help her to resist the snacks, but she also has to change the world.
Yes.
She has
out of sight, out of mind.
Because that visual cue, that's powerful.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, listen, I would gain 10 pounds on that.
Okay. That's what I said.
And
I don't blame her.
I said, you know, let's have a meeting, and, you know, let's see if we can maybe put the food over there.
That's a wonderful suggestion. Like, you know, the further distance you can be from the food, the severely decreases the chances you'll go for it.
You know, I tell people environment trumps all.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, whatever's in front of us, that's what we're going to eat. You know, you've given me something, that's what I'm going to have.
Absolutely.
And so if I have to go get something else, it's harder, you know?
So what are some good suggestions that you gave her to maybe put on that table rather than those, like, calorie-dense foods?
Well, first of all, it's not even good food, bad food. It's timing.
Right.
She doesn't need to be eating all day long. You know, it's just going 3 hours without eating. So each meal should have some protein mm-hmm. and some fiber and some healthy carbs and a little bit of fat. And so we came up with a plan for breakfast and a plan for lunch and a plan for dinner. And some strategies.
And evaluated the need for really eating throughout
right,
the day.
Right, right, right. We just don't need to be eating constantly.
Especially if you're sitting down writing comedy.
And when we look at America and the problem we have with obesity now, over the last, you know, since the 50s, 60s, 70s, the preponderance of food, big food, you know, sugar, fat, salt, mm-hmm. coming at us 24/7 with huge portions, it's easy to understand why Americans have a hard time controlling
Absolutely.
Their weight. There's just too much. You go to the gas station.
There's everywhere.
There's everything. So every time you turn, you take your kid to the soccer game. There's bagels.
Right.
You
know? Of course. Of course. So you know, I think your idea of just evaluating the pattern
right.
is really key to changing the everyday actual food that you
right.
consume.
Right. So one of the biggest risk factors for overweight are those people who tend to be very reactive to food cues. So when they're standing in line at the bank, they take a candy.
Right.
You know? And so we want to end casual eating.
Right.
We want to work on saying, that's not for me. I'm not having that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, to avoid eating popcorn at the movies because you know you're going to go to dinner later. So that's another really important rule that I like to introduce. The first step is always know what and when you're going to eat next.
Very smart. That's a great tip.
So, because if you know that you're going to have lunch after you leave the bank, then you're not going to have a candy because you know you're going to lunch.
Excellent. So it's kind of like thinking ahead, planning ahead, and
right.
getting those patterns in check.
Right.
Mary, thank you so much for coming today.
Thank you for having me.
Can you tell the audience how we can contact you if we'd like?
Let's see. Email.
Okay.
How about that? MaryDonkersloot@gmail.com.
Excellent. And do you have a website?
I have a website. It's MaryDonkersloot.com.
Excellent. Thank you so much
Thank
for coming
you for
on
having
today.
Me. Thank you.
For more on living healthy, living well, be sure to subscribe to emPOWerme.tv. Follow us on Twitter and like us on Facebook.